On this episode of Latina, we'll take a look back at some of the very best segments from this past season. Latinas starts now. Welcome to Latinas, the show that's all about nuestras mujeres in the Latinx community. I'm Tinabeth Piña. Last month, we showed you some of our very best segments of the season, and today, we're gonna share even more. How awesome is that? Now, can you believe that it's already been over a year and a half since the CDC reported its first coronavirus case in the US and turned our lives upside down? And as we continue to pick up the pieces, we're also learning how the pandemic has unfortunately forced many Latinas to actually leave a job they worked so hard to attain. Here's one woman's story.
I grew up as a Latina where my mom said, you work, you never depend on anyone, you never depend on a man, you go to school, you get a job, you make a career. I did all the things in the order that I was supposed to do them. And now I was making a decision to leave to support my family.
Farida Mercedes was an HR executive at L'Oreal for 17 years before she voluntarily decided to leave her job last fall due to the toll the pandemic was taking on her family life. She is now a full-time stay-at-home mom.
I couldn't imagine being a stay-at-home mom, and I respect them 100%. It wasn't who I was. And to make the conscious decision to leave while friends around me and people around me were losing their jobs was very, very hard. I just wasn't happy, and I wasn't able to show up for my family as well as struggling with showing up the way I wanted to at work. It was so difficult.
According to the Bureau of Labor Statistics, 865,000 women dropped out of the labor force last September, compared to 216,000 men. And there are over 2 million fewer women in the workforce now than there were in 2020. Experts say that almost half of the women leaving or losing their jobs are Latina.
The biggest chunk was that Latina, 324,000. Were either furloughed or laid off, but most of them made the difficult decision to say, you know what? The thing that's most important for me right now is taking care of my family, going to the supermarket, and making sure that they're not falling behind on their learning.
Why do you think it's more women versus men?
I think it's that traditional role, right? I think it's the traditional role of making sure that the women know what's best for the family, how they can provide. We're also incredible multitaskers, right? So we can make sure that we are providing and building a community and a home that's going to be successful.
When someone like Farida chooses to leave her job to make sure everything is taken care of at home, that decision can come with a lot of guilt.
I cried a lot. There were a lot of days of crying because I wasn't sure if it was the right decision. And I have many, many friends who unfortunately were either furloughed during the pandemic, lost their roles during the pandemic. And as an HR professional, speaking to people at work who I had to unfortunately deliver news of they no longer had a role, I did feel guilty. I know that there's a lot of people who have said to me, I wish I could do that, but I need to feed my family. And I get that. But you need to fill your own cup so that you can fill the cup of others. There are so many outside things that are happening with the pandemic and other things that are happening that can put extra stress on you that many people don't look at. So taking care of yourself first is so important.
Taking care of yourself can have different meanings for different people, but the time that Farida has taken for herself has proven to be priceless.
In a way, you're richer now than you were when you had your job, right?
Before, what made me feel accomplished was, what is the next title, that title that I was in, or I just got that salary increase that I was really looking forward to. And now my wealth is in time, the time that I get to spend with them. I want to nurture that time that I have with my kids. So that may mean that I don't go for that VP title because I want more time with my kids. And I realize now that that's what I want.
One of the most anticipated movies of the year, In the Heights, is finally in theaters with Olga Merediz as the unforgettable Abuela Claudia. The Cuban-American actress is reprising her Tony-nominated role in the film and shares with us her journey as a Latina actress.
Ugh, it smells like you're cooking Bambi, Mom.
I'm making you a steak, mijo.
Mom, practicing veganism.
I thought you had a girlfriend. Vegan doesn't mean gay, Mom. Mijo, posture.
I came from Cuba. I didn't study to be an actress. I was not going to be an actress. I don't think my family wanted me to be an actress, but I kept doing it on the side. I was driving people, friends, to New York to audition. And then I said, why don't I audition? And so I decided to audition, and it just happened very quickly, and I've been very lucky.
So should we meet the kids?
Sure, yeah. 30 minutes.
You know, that's insane.
Just get it done.
Finally, the boy has found his guts, you know?
Well, I have played many different roles. I've played the subservient, you know, like I've played many maids. But I'm thinking, you know, I have a cleaning lady and she's terrific. But as a Latina, I would like to play more diverse and powerful women and any kind.
The House doesn't vote until January 6th. If you can resolve this Iran issue peacefully before then, we'll switch to Dalton.
Sometimes as an actor, you have to decide, do I want to work? Or, you know, is there something, is there a quality in this woman? Is there a message or something that you want to do this role? And so you do the role.
Why?
Because she's going to hit me.
I didn't love you. I didn't. And after all these years, I finally felt like we were starting to get along. But all this finger pointing, you have to admit, is a big turnoff.
I started out in theater, and that was my home. And you have some incredible highs on stage when you're in that zone and you feel like the audience is with you. They gave me the opportunity to switch roles and do the abuela. The grandmother, again, I didn't think I could do it because I thought, I don't know, I want to really be genuine. But they thought I could do it and it worked out really well.
I am Usnavian. You probably never heard my name.
You know, it was all this rapping, and in my ear was not used to all the rapping. You know, I guess because, you know, I was much older than all the kids. And now I love it.
Pan caliente, café con leche.
I had to kind of go back for the film version, and I actually had my original notes of music, so that gave me a base, and then everybody can relate to her because everybody has had an abuela Claudia.
I'm making moves.
And I'm so happy I did it, so happy to be a part of it. I feel lucky. I do help young actors. I get emails all the time. I have a friend, I have so-and-so's daughter. They want to have a coffee with you, and I try to see where they are, what they want, and what their goals are, and see if I can help them, you know, direct them in the right way.
Little details that tell the world we are not invisible.
Menopause. We've all heard about it, but what do we really know about it? Ask any woman going through it, and they'll say something like, no one ever told me it was going to be like this. Coming up are three Latinas who are about to tell you what their mommies didn't tell them about menopause on today's Caliente Caliente.
Menopause is more complicated than menstrual cycle. Maybe it's not. Maybe we're getting more information. But like from what I remember, when you got your period, okay, you got your period, you use a pad. Sometimes it lasts 3 days. Some people it's seven. Some it's light. Some it's heavy. Some it's cramped. Some it's not. But it's the same five or six symptoms that everybody has and talks about. And I think with menopause, it's much broader. It's so many more different symptoms that last so many more years. And now they talk about perimenopause. So you start getting, you know, different things even before you become menopausal. And there still is the taboo across all levels, you know? So who do I talk about it with? My primas? That's it, right? And or I do research on the internet.
For me, I didn't get anything. It wasn't talked about. I knew it was gonna happen. I didn't know when, I didn't know how, but because of my mom went through it and I was there, I saw what it looked like. I did not want it.
I feel very privileged because my mother was always very open about just the overall process of the menstrual cycle. And she was always very forthcoming because she did not like the fact that her mother, my grandmother, who lived with us, didn't speak about the subject.
My mother had very little symptoms. And you know how they say that your menstrual cycle and your menopause is similar to your mother's. And so she didn't think it was a big deal, probably just, oh, you'll be fine. It's nothing. Then I ended up having a surgical menopause. I had to have surgery and a hysterectomy and for some cysts I had in my ovaries. And that was more shocking than even the normal stages of menopause because it happened suddenly. And obviously the male, older male physicians don't prepare you for what's going to happen, from a loss of libido to a total, even, you know, acute depression. And even as a doctor, I had patients that were just so affected by the hot flashes and not being able to sleep.
I had a hysterectomy as well. I was 36. And for me, it took a while to get there, but the symptoms, they just last longer. Oh my God. And by the time I hit 38, the mind fog was so bad. I had an issue understanding language.
And but that's the thing, that it's so different for every woman and for so many people. And so, you know, you may be talking about a bunch of symptoms that I've never felt, or I may be talking about a bunch that you've never felt. And that's why sharing them and with all different levels of life, right? When you're in your 40s and perimenopause and 50s and 60s, because, you know, otherwise you think, wait a minute, I didn't have that.
For me, I've noticed how my metabolism has slowed. Right. So even if I don't eat sugar, even if I don't eat gluten, even if I don't, you know, don't, I find myself having a really difficult time with my own body. Right. How it's just slowed down. I think I judge myself more. Right. Because, oh, my God. Ahora estoy vieja.
No, never that. I never really thought about it that, like, I never saw myself as being vieja o seca. I'm 48 now. I'm living total freedom now.
I think it's been a very, very internal journey of accepting. It's okay that I'm changing, that I'm aging. I'm still feminine. I'm still full of desire, full of passion, full of life, full of, it's just in a different pace.
Hello, cutie.
She comes with history. Emmy, Grammy, Oscar, and Tony.
I was really drawn to her. She made me feel like a woman could do anything because she did. She was a Latina, like me.
She just brings such authority and such honesty to whatever she's playing.
Some people might view Rita Moreno as the embodiment of the American dream.
At the age of 16 years old, she was the sole breadwinner for her family.
Little Puerto Rican girl whom nobody thought much of.
At MGM with a contract.
Wear your nationality like a flag. Be proud of it. Be proud, you're Puerto Rican. Be proud, you're Puerto Rican.
We always have to prove we're worthwhile. That's a lot of work.
At 87, with a hit show and a movie in the works, it's a remake of West Side Story with Latino actors in the lead role.
If we thought there was no place for us in this world of the arts that we wanted to get into, we could look up and see Rita and say, okay, well, she could do it. How close can I get?
Arthritis is a very common condition. It's not well understood. Over 4 million Latinos have been diagnosed with the disease, and our correspondent, Elena Romero, is one of them. Here's her story.
There are more than 100 different types of arthritis that cause pain, stiffness, swelling, and limited movement in the joints and various parts of the body. Contrary to popular belief, arthritis is not an old person's disease. It affects people of all ages, genders, and ethnicities. I should know, because I've been living with arthritis for the past 7 years.
You're on the younger spectrum of someone that'll come in with arthritis.
And it wasn't only osteos, he also had psoriatic arthritis. It's a bit different to osteo. So with psoriatic, you get a little bit more stiffness. And that's one of the hurdles that we were facing. And a lot of elbow stiffness. The ankle wasn't too bad at the time when he first came in, a bit stiff, causing you to walk with a cane.
Arthritis runs in my family. Mommy was diagnosed with osteoarthritis in her early 40s and became wheelchair bound because of it. Abuela had a milder case and self-medicated with Bengay. Dr. Gary Zagon at NYU Langone has been treating me since my initial diagnosis at age 41.
What's the treatment for arthritis?
There's no one treatment. There are multiple treatments. And it really depends upon what you think the arthritis is coming from. Mechanical arthritis, like osteoarthritis, it's everywhere between just pain medications, local injections, physical therapy, and then eventually maybe joint replacement. For the inflammatory arthritis, it depends upon what's triggering the inflammation.
We don't know the true number of people with arthritis because many don't seek treatment until their symptoms become severe. In my case, the arthritis started out as mild and later progressed to severe, affecting every joint in my body. Treatment for my psoriatic arthritis and osteoarthritis consists of monthly infusion medication and physical therapy.
Getting a diagnosis of arthritis necessarily mean that disability is in their future?
No, and that's just the point, is that with all the modalities that we have, we can help so many more people.
Physical therapy twice a week over an extended period of time helped me regain the mobility I lost this fall.
The biggest thing you want to do is help to alleviate symptoms. The biggest symptoms that we find are pain and stiffness. To get an idea of what is tailored best for them is the best route to go down.
Dr. Zagon and therapist Cardenas advise arthritis patients not to panic because it is very common and treatable.
The patient plays the biggest role. The doctor can only point the way. The patient really has to take it on themselves to become very active, being their own advocate, finding out what resources are available to them.
Just make sure that you have a good medical and rehab team behind you. So I think the biggest thing is to know that it's not an acute situation, it's not an acute diagnosis. So it's not a sprint, it's a marathon.
For Latinas, I'm Elena Romero.
When you see yourself online during Zoom calls or Skype meetings, do you wish you looked better? Emmy Award-winning makeup artist and online video coach, Sue Perez, is gonna give us mujeres a few pointers to help make our online video appearances the very best they can be.
We're doing conference calls, international conference calls. We're doing education. There's never been such a, you know, increase in online learning than there is right now. So I think every single person should be aware of how they look online, how they sound. I don't think we've ever been in this place like we are right now, and it's not gonna change. It's only gonna stay this way going forward. I would say the number one thing that I see women not doing is wearing enough makeup. They just vanish on camera. And it's almost like you can go a little bit heavier now. Your skin tone is gonna look more washed out. I see more tech issues, women that don't understand the value of using a background or using really good lighting or ring light. I think makeup-wise, just wearing enough makeup, you know, even using fake eyelashes, you know, they don't have to be dramatic looking. I have small wispies on right now. I'm not wearing a full band of fake lashes, but it does make an enhancement that I think a lot of like Latina women just miss doing. I think that when women put on makeup, they put on maybe powder. They don't even think in terms of like foundation. And there's a lot of people that are concerned about under the eye area, right? So that's a big deal. And if we look puffy, how do we conceal that? So I think understanding what your skin tone is and going a shade lighter underneath the eyes. I sometimes even use just different colors of base, and I customize my foundation to my skin, because if you're light-skinned and you want to look a little bit more tanned, the beauty is you can tweak your makeup on camera and look a little bit more golden. And if you're very dark, you can add a little highlighter and kind of like create more highlights and some more contour angles on your face for on camera. But under the eye area, it should look matte, it should look kind of even and not too much powder. If I could choose one thing that I think could be a universal thing for all women, regardless of your age, would be the lips. Don't go so dark. I think don't go too dark. Like, and what I mean is, like, if you're wearing makeup or maybe you don't like to wear makeup and you think your lips are the most important thing, don't wear that bold red lipstick or really super dark burgundy lipstick. I think you should think in terms of what looks like more natural on camera, but use your lip pencil to define your lip line and also go light on lip gloss. Hair is so personal because everybody has their preference of what they like. I think it should be up to you, but the number one thing is you just want to see your eyes, because right now we're connecting online and we're looking into a camera lens. We don't have the benefit of looking into somebody's eyes right now. So I would just say, make sure that your hair is pulled away from your eyes and we can see your eyes. It's so important, especially now during COVID and we have masks on when we're in person, we're missing out on seeing all the verbal cues that people give us. So just let's see your eyes.
For more online tips from Sue Perez, check out dynamicvideocoach.com. Brooklyn-based visual artist Gemma Gené has gone viral with her online comic series, 157 of Gemma, which has led to the launch of her newest book, Living with Mochi. And that's why she's today's Latina on the Rise.
My comic is called 157 of Gemma, and it's about living with my pack mochi. When I moved to New York, I was working as an architect, and I miss Mochi so much during the day that I started drawing about him on my subway commute. I started posting the comics on our Instagram, and they took off because people related to them so much. My name is Gemma Gené. I'm a visual artist from Barcelona. I do two lines of work. One is a comic book, and the other one is fine art. 157 of Gemma is the project that I'm most known for. We have a large audience, and what I like about it is that we created a community, and people are very supportive. We have a lot of fun. It's very easy for me because I only have to watch. Like, I stare at my dog all day. Like, I just look at him all day, and he does all these cute little things that I feel every dog owner can relate to. It's the best job ever to just look at my favorite creature on earth and then just draw about him. We published a book. It's called Living with Mochi, and it's a compilation of our best comics and with some inedit comics that only exist in the book. And we also have stickers, and the cover is super fun. So I'm very, very excited. My fine art work is mostly paintings in oil paint. And I do photorealistic paintings of objects that I edit so the object tells a story. I did a series of balloons that they were inflating and deflating, and compositions with several balloons and also wrapped objects. And I always use metallic colors and very bright colors. At the beginning of the pandemic, I thought my work would be a very good outlet. And I wanted to do some work about fear and anxiety because it's what I felt. Like, especially at the beginning, I was scared, I didn't know what was going on, but it happened the opposite for me. At the beginning, I just couldn't produce. I was overwhelmed, and I thought, you know what? It's okay to not do anything, you know? It's a very complicated situation, and not everyone needs to use this time to get a nice body and learn a new skill, you know? Like, I'm not gonna be that person. I'm just gonna survive this, stay home, and just relax. But I don't know, it evolved, and I've been very, very inspired lately, which is, it's amazing and very surprising. The new series I'm working on with my paintings is about all these feelings that we have and hide, and all these things in life that we maybe are scared or shy or we don't want to share with the world, but they are valid. And to represent that, I'm using very beautiful Swarovski crystals. This series is the most conceptual series I've ever worked on. The concept is different because I look inwards instead of outwards. And it's a big challenge because I'm using a different medium, which I've never used. New scale, new everything. So I'm very intimidated, but I'm also very excited. I started being an architect and an artist. And I feel like I have many passions and I like following all of them. I think one thing I'm very grateful for is that I'm not afraid of failing. I'm not afraid of failing or being ridiculed. And I think this is very liberating because I can always start again. I don't care.
And that's our show for today. For more information on what you just saw, check out our website at tv.cuny.edu and follow our social media profiles. We love sharing our Latina stories with you. And please make sure you tune in next time where we'll premiere season 3 of Latinas. Can you believe that? And I can't wait to show you what we have in store. ¡Uepa! Hasta la próxima. Bye-bye.
You're better off than you were with the birds of La Vibora.
Sharing double beds, trying to catch a break, struggling with English. Listening to friends, finally got a job working as a maid. So we cleaned some homes, polishing with pride, scrubbing the whole of the Upper East Side. The days into weeks, the weeks into years, and here I stay.